In this third section, we saw his views about the ortho function. Here in section 4 of this essay, Foucault takes off in a different direction. Now, what is his aim here? Here, his aim is to show that the ortho function applies not just to individual works, but also to larger discourses. Now, discourses, the term discourses refers to kind of spoken conversation or written conversation, or written text, we can say. So it does not simply refer to any individual work. It refers to larger discourses. So in this very famous section on founders of discursivity, means he refers to Marx, a Freud, who produce their own text. Okay, plus the possibilities or the rules for the formation of other texts. He talks about the founders of discursivity. He talks about Marx or Freud, their text, and then he talks about the possibility or the rules for the formation of other texts based on this discussion. Now, he talks about a scientist. No? According to Foucault, scientists can't really be founders of discursivity. Okay, this to discursive means something which is, you know, postponing, we can say. While making this statement, he seems to be distinguishing scientific discourses. He brings out the difference between scientific writing from discourses like that of psychoanalysis. In scientific discourses, he suggests there are a limited number of possible statements. Now, if you want to talk about something, you talk directly. You don't postpone your ideas. Whereas in psychoanalysis, the number of possible statements is not and cannot be limited. Now, for example, in literary theory as well, we have this discursivity. Yes, there is no single statement as such. As in science, there is a limited number of possible statements exist. Whereas in psychoanalysis, possible statements is not and cannot be limited. That's what he says. And in section 5, he tries to wrap, you know, things. He wraps up things and points out a few reasons why he's bothered with this particular subject in the first place. Why is he worrying? Why is he talking about author and authorship? He raises the possibility of doing a historical analysis of discourse. He talks about the possibility. And then he notes that the author function has operated differently in different places at different times. So this is to be understood. It may not be universal as such. It has operated differently in different places and at different times. And he comments about the subject, which are very difficult to be seen, which are hard to decipher. We see that Foucault begins his essay by questioning a tendency to imagine authors as individuals isolated from the rest of the society. He begins like this. Then he is raising the same sort of question here in the last section as well. Rather, he takes it a further step, you can say. He suggests that if we stop thinking of authors as isolated individuals, we may also be able to stop thinking about other people and kinds of people in that way. Okay? If we stop doing so, if we stop thinking that authors are isolated individuals from the rest of society, we may be able to stop thinking of other people in this way. We should stop thinking that way. And at the end of this essay, he argues that author is not a source of infinite meaning. As we imagine that if you understand the author, the intentions of the authors, it is easier for us to understand the text. But Foucault thinks that author is not a source of infinite meaning, as we imagine, but rather part of a larger system of beliefs. So you might be knowing that post-structuralist and structuralist focus on the first aspect, first side of Saussure's dichotomy, binary oppositions we understood. So author is a part of larger system of beliefs. These people, you know, even Saussure himself was more interested in Lamb, not in Perrault. They were more interested in the underlying system, not in the individuals, not in the paroles. Paroles are the manifestations. So the author is not an infinite source of meaning. It is the individual manifestation of the underlying system, rather part of a larger system of beliefs that serve to limit and restrict meaning. And at the very end, Foucault returns to Barthes and agrees that the author function may soon disappear. Means we know in his reader response criticism, in his book on the death of the author, Roland Barthes declares the death of the author, the role of the author. He agrees with Roland Barthes in that way, because the author function may soon disappear. Whatever characteristics are associated with the author may disappear. Of course, he does not suggest that the limiting and restrictive author function will have some kind of absolute freedom. Okay. And he talks about one set of restrictions and limits, which will give way to another set. So ultimately, he suggests that, or he insists on the fact that there must and will always be some system of constraint working upon us. So what is he doing, trying to do through this essay is, he's trying to focus on the underlying system, okay, the source, the larger system of beliefs, which restrict or limit the meaning. Okay, this is actually an outline of the essay. The original essay is very big one. It is not possible for us to go line by line, but I shall discuss some more things related to the essay in my next part of discussion.